It's the morning show with EVH. I'm Eric Von Hessler. There, right there, is Autumn Fisher.
Hello.
And right next to Autumn Fisher is Michael Albanese.
Whatever, bro.
Who got here very early today. It's quite suspicious.
I was the first one.
When you show up early, I think, okay, was he fleeing a crime? I don't know. We'll get into that. Speaking of fleeing crimes, here's a man who has a lot weighing on his conscience.
The CEO of entertainment in Hollywood, right here with you today.
We changed title.
Is that your title now? The CEO of broadcast entertainment, the best damn basement internet producer that I've ever met, Greg Russ.
Don't pigeonhole me as just a producer.
I don't think you can do
it. I've quit radio jobs for stuff like that.
Keep him in the basement, just don't pigeonhole him to radio.
Why did you, exactly? It wasn't the basement thing that bothered him. It's just, I'm not just a producer. I can do all kinds of things in basements.
Basements don't bother me. I'm used to spending my time in, well, it's not a basement, but my apartment gets...
Seems like a basement.
It gets 15 minutes of direct sunlight a day, around 8:30 in the morning. But across the street, they've knocked down the two-story children's center that was there, and now they've put up like a 10-story building, so the sun doesn't come in at all.
Directly. So now you've lost your 15 minutes.
Oh. I have.
Was that a big deal? Like did you set your chair in front of the window for that to get your 15 minutes?
I know you didn't go outside. And lay on the floor like a cat in front of the sun?
It was set up, the bed, so the sunlight hit my face, and it was like the wake-up call. And I'll never wake up if I live in that apartment.
Well, it's not really. Sleep. It's a very, very small place. I know I had to stay there one time, and I loved it. I loved it. I liked being with my friend Greg. We were out about 3:30 in the morning. We were having fun. We were enjoying ourselves. And I slept in a chair. But the only thing, Greg's apartment, it's literally a big chair.
It's an oversized chair.
It's too big for that room, quite frankly. But I guess I'm glad.
It's a one-seater, and it is taking up some space.
There's the bathroom is like here. And you walk out of the bathroom, and there's about 2 inches of linoleum. And then you know that
there's no linoleum. No.
Oh, okay.
See,
well,
then you're
I'm making stuff up.
Incredible. Now
I'm making stuff up.
Do you
it was
mean
a while
tile?
Ago.
Yeah. No, it's all
meant,
hardwood.
But it's not. It's not. Yeah.
There's no. Yeah. The kitchen's not even big enough. I don't know why you put linoleum in.
Well, I thought there was a little strip there, but you walk out of the bathroom and you're in the kitchen.
2 feet by 3 feet.
Yeah. And then you're in the bedroom / living room / closet. Is the rest of the place. But it's cozy.
Wanted me to give him the bed.
I never said filthy sheets.
No. Michael Albanese is going to be staying in my apartment.
I am.
When he goes up
very excited
to New York for his documentary.
Did you hide all the porn?
No, who keeps porn these days?
Nobody has porn.
That's true. Yeah,
you
it's
don't
on
need
the computer.
To.
You mean you guys don't go? You guys don't have a stack of magazines?
You know what? Underneath my bed, I guarantee there's some DVDs from the '96 rock days because they used to ship that in.
Yeah,
and that was great. I was an intern. I was like, I'm taking this before anyone else finds it.
the prize closet.
How do you feel?
I have a Paris one, the Paris Hilton one. Oh, One Night in Paris.
Was that the DVD? That was an actual. I thought that was just something people saw online.
Oh no, it was a DVD. Oh,
the
it's
one where
a DVD.
She's green.
She's green?
Infrared?
Yeah, she wasn't that good at it. She was pretty new to the film. Oh, you mean like color was?
It was her first film.
Yeah.
I never actually saw that.
Oh, it's terrible.
Yeah, no,
like,
no, me neither. Sure.
She says ew a lot, and she says it like this, ew.
It's like that Jimmy Fallon bit
Stop
that he does
it.
On The Tonight Show. Ew. It's really funny.
I don't know, because I haven't seen Fallon on The Tonight Show yet.
No,
I haven't
you
seen
need
anything.
To. It's
still
good.
Out of it, you know? I DVR Ferguson, and I barely get to... Kind of get those things. I like his show, but
such a rebel.
Yeah, I like Ferguson.
I was talking about you.
I know. I'm a rebel. I am a rebel. Lick my nuts. Don't get me started.
Hey, that was yesterday.
Lick my nuts. Don't get me started.
Lick my nuts. Part two begins now. Let me tell you, people. Let me tell the rest of the world to go to hell. So, Autumn had first of all. Before I get to that, how long are you going to stay at Greg's place?
Like a couple days.
Okay,
a couple days. And I'll be able to Skype in.
No. Okay, that's great. I'm just wondering. You know, you're not going to do anything in there. Are you going to have a 2-day moratorium on, like, I don't masturbate because I'm in somebody else's
You know, I don't care
apartment.
About that.
I'm going to Greg's. It'd be weird if I didn't. I'm pretty sure it's probably mandatory.
You don't mind
mandatory.
That he'll be laying on the same bed that you lay on?
No.
It's not going to bother you.
No, that doesn't bother me. I'll change the sheets. The thing is, I'm not going to tell you if I change the sheets or not. I have two sets of sheets. So my decision going into this was either I change the sheets now, then I have to wash them when I go back because he's going to make the clean sheets dirty, or I leave the dirty sheets on and I let him sleep on those. That way, when I get back, I can immediately put on the clean sheets.
So you'll be sitting in his swill.
Well, here's the thing. I'm doing road gigs the week before that, and I always carry fresh sheets with me, a fresh bedding set, because you never know if you're going to be in a comedy condo because they can always switch you at the last minute.
Right.
And so I always have fresh sheets, and I always keep soap and shampoo with me.
Smart.
So in case I have to sleep in a filthy condo. I'm ready.
All your Beard Bar products, I'm sure.
Yeah, absolutely.
Give yourself a plug. Beard Bar.
Beardbars.com.
It's a beard.
I wash my whole body with it.
Beardbars.com.
Yeah, Beard Bars.
I've never really asked you much about this. Is it a soap?
But there are no soaps in it. It's a shampoo.
Okay. It's not the same thing.
Look, I got killed by my partner by kept calling it soap.
What is the difference between soap and shampoo?
There's like certain chemicals in soaps, and we don't use any chemicals.
Oh, you're
they're all natural.
You're totally organic.
No, not organic, but we're natural.
Right.
Organic soaps are hard to make.
You know, my wife has a friend who is a bit of a hippie, and they make their own soap, which I can't understand for the life of me. This is why you could go down and you could buy like 8,000 bars of ivory for $5.
People have hobbies, Eric. Look where you're at.
Okay, exactly. this is my hobby. So, but they're always terrible. Have you ever tried those soaps that are made? They don't lather.
Like, yeah, ours are amazing.
Lather. Yeah. Soap without lather is not soap.
No. Ours lather pretty hard. They're good.
Isn't it that we're just expecting everything to lather, but it doesn't have to lather to clean?
Well, how do you know that it's on there? You want it to lather up.
Because it feels like you're doing something.
I mean, that'd be like you're brushing your teeth and just like going once over and you're done. You froth it up, right?
That's how you brush your teeth, though, right?
The lather's like the spinning indicator on a computer. It's not actually doing anything. It's just there for your comfort.
That's
working.
Yeah,
that's what the lather does. Because yeah, you're right. You can get clean without lather.
How?
Yeah.
But I mean, I don't feel it on my hands.
We're just used to it. You know, we're just trained.
Just a film at that point of soap, and then it washes off.
Yeah.
It captures all the dirt. And
I believe that the lather makes it better because
it does make it better.
You're getting in there.
It feels better.
That's what I'm saying. Mentally, it makes it better.
Feels better.
I think it's a little physically. I think there's some truth to it as well.
Let's get the scientists.
The more soap you use, the cleaner you get.
The soap scientists.
Hello. Yeah. If there's anybody out there who's ever made soap on their own, let me know why you can't make soap at home that lathers.
Sitting next to the guy who makes his own.
So you got a company that does it, but I mean, do you do it in your house and then
we have a manufacturer.
How big are the bars? Why don't you bring one in and promote yourself a little bit?
Yeah, sure.
I've never even seen your logo or anything.
Yeah,
you don't wear.
I don't wear hats.
You don't
wear
hats.
It's not about me here. It's the Eric Von Radio Show.
Do you have a hat?
I'll be the first sponsor.
I was going to say Autumn can bring back the schlag.
Oh, exactly.
And she can test the soap in the schlag
on your belly.
That's cute.
It's good. You can watch people use it for their whole body. It's actually a really, really interesting product. So.
Well, I would think the men would do that.
I thought
it would only work on beards.
It's specially designed for beards, which is one of the toughest. Because it's coarse.
Yeah.
But there's also the face skin is different than the rest of the skin on your body. So
and
this
that's
actually
why
treats the skin underneath the beard is what it targets.
Right.
Healthy skin equals healthy beard.
Is that a logo?
Is that your slogan?
Are you
that's
slogan?
Our logo.
Yeah.
That's very good.
One of our slogans. We have many. Also says, don't keep a dirty beard, you fucking idiot. That's one of the other ones, but that's a different.
It's for the adult crowd.
Yeah, that's the adults, yeah.
Yeah, so you have to tell me that I can use it somewhere besides it says beard bars.
Yeah, it says it on the label.
So
you
I would
can read
think
it.
That if I use this anywhere outside of that,
I'm going to get a big rash,
a big rash. That happened to me once. I used the
not with beard bars.
I used the body soap for my face.
Because your face has different skin.
That's right.
Yeah.
And then I had to go to a wedding with a big red, thing. So I'm very sensitive to this.
I fell
sort
down
of thing.
The stairs.
I wear big sunglasses.
Yeah.
People are looking at my wife like, hey, she hit him again.
Somebody's she reached
something.
All the way up there and just whopped you one.
Yes. She climbed a ladder and smacked me in the face. Autumn.
Yeah.
I think this might be a little bit embarrassing. That's why I bring it
up. Yeah, it is a little embarrassing.
She came in saying,
let's talk about
if it's embarrassing, embarrassing equals entertaining.
Yay.
Yay. So she walks in and she says, I wrote a mantra to myself. Is it mantra or mantra?
Mantra.
I wrote a mantra to myself.
Yeah.
And I put it in this little pocket of her purse or something. And she said, then she lost it. And now she's embarrassed. She's afraid somebody's going to find it because it's really embarrassing. And I don't know what the mantra was.
Did you sign it? Is it going to be traceable to you?
No, but I thought if I lost it here, everyone would know it was mine.
Yeah.
What is this weird mantra?
I write mantras. Don't worry.
Do you?
I usually then cross them out and circle them and write a big arrow. Leading to the margin saying no, bad idea.
That's
to
yourself.
You get a red pen and correct your own mantras.
That's the note taking.
That's neurosis.
When I take notes or ideas and I write them down, I ultimately circle them or cross things out and write a big no or needs work next to it.
Right.
And I think I brought this up before only because
this is great. Let's have the context here before you tell exactly what happens here. It's like a notebook or something like that. Ideas, maybe comedy ideas, maybe film ideas, just ideas that you have. And so you write down the ideas, and then...
And then I circle them and draw an arrow to the margin and write in the margin, no, dumb idea, needs work, even though I think that maybe it's a good idea. Just in case I die and someone else reads it, they don't think that I thought it was a good idea. I don't want to be judged.
Now that's neurotic.
See, so don't worry. If we find your your mantra,
so what
was
your,
it?
First, before you tell us the exact thing, what was the? Give us the general category. Like, what are we trying to focus on with this mantra? What are we trying to fix
during the show? Right, we have a certain like dynamic that goes on that is different than our personal interaction. Yeah. So, being pregnant, I feel a little bit more vulnerable. And
you're more emotional.
More emotional and. Yeah. Intellectually, I understand that there is a clear difference between what happens on the show and what happens outside the show.
Mm-hmm. Was that code for man versus woman?
Yeah.
Intellectually?
Yeah, kind of.
Yeah. Just tacking away at your vulnerability. Sure. I'll get her.
Let's make her cry. Come on, I need people to find out about this show. We make her cry.
Turns out she's a girl this whole time. I thought she was just a...
tough.
Just a chubby dude.
So this mantra...
child in there.
So the mantra was like almost like a cleansing sort of idea of like before the show and after the show, I'm going to say something to myself that's going to make me feel like, okay... The show is different than my personal life.
Do we attack you on the show? Do you feel?
Sometimes if we're talking about something, it's very like man versus woman, and or
I
like women are this way, and
chubby
men
dude,
or
and
Michael
I
just talks over you
that.
Because you're a woman, which he wouldn't
exactly.
Do.
Otherwise.
I was apologizing. I just called her a chubby dude, and I realized like that's you shouldn't say that to anybody. That's a silly thing, even though we're goofing around.
But I mean, she realizes
ball busting per se.
Well, and that's what I'm saying. Intellectually, I totally get ball busting,
you're
and
going
I'm
after retards.
What's that?
On our show.
I have?
Well, I mean, you went after the, I mean, you've been humorous about things.
Exactly.
That if somebody knew that person, they would be very pissed off.
Right. Like, and so I get that. Like I said, intellectually, I totally understand that. But emotionally, sometimes I carry it home a little bit and I think about the conversation and then my heart beats fast. Mm-hmm. And then I have like a mini, like tiny panic attack like at the laundromat. I was like,
what?
Yes. I just like,
smell of.
I know. Thank you.
Welcome.
I just felt like.
How can the smell, with this, I could not have a panic attack with the smell of fresh laundry around me.
Oh, you can.
So.
Well, with
comforting.
With all of the laundry machines, it's kind of not fresh laundry.
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
like wet.
And they're loud.
Things.
They're rackety. It's
well,
not
and there's
pleasant.
Some like disco music playing, and anyway, so I have a really cool laundromat. But
well, Autumn, it's funny that you look what I found in the driveway yesterday.
Yes,
lies.
What is her mantra, Greg?
She's gonna have a panic attack right now.
Remember,
we're reading it.
Palm Pilot set list.
No, that's not, he's lying.
What is that?
Edit notes for something I had.
Oh,
I was just hoping she would panic, and it didn't work.
What my heart was beating a little bit faster, even though I knew it was a lie. Still, was like, oh god.
What is your mantra?
Something about like the show is different than my reality.
Something. Tell me what.
I don't remember.
How long?
That's why I wrote
just
down
a few
three
words?
Things. Three things.
A few words.
I wrote things down like wash hands, breathe. Like, I thought maybe before the show I'd wash my hands and then breathe, say this mantra, breathe in between each thing, and then at the end.
I didn't realize it was such a psychological thing.
Well, like
doing
I said.
The show. I know you got the chemicals.
Yeah, exactly. The hormones.
I'm used to you being a very, very tough chick.
And that's, and like I said, that is how I feel I am.
Yeah.
But I also am feeling all these other things that I can't control, so I thought.
You need Scientology. They'll get rid of that stuff.
Yeah,
you know,
the
there's no chemical.
Emirates, what are they called?
Excuse me, Thetans.
Thetans.
Come on, let's wake up.
The Emirates.
You can't get cleared if you don't know what you're clearing.
Yep.
So you need Tom Cruise, who would tell you that there's no such thing as a chemical imbalance or anything to do with chemicals. It's all made up by psychiatrists to write things. Well, no, wait a minute. Michael Albanese told me that, not Tom. It's all made up by psychiatrists to sell you drugs and all that kind of stuff.
That would suck, though, actually.
Look at him. He made Top Gun, so why not do what he does? He's doing it right.
It's funny. If I were married to him, that way of thinking seems like he's trying to be very helpful. Like, it's all made up. It's all in your mind. But then what it's saying to you is like, you are nuts. Like, you are crazy for thinking that. So there's something wrong with you now.
You're not as clean as I am. You're not as clear as I am.
That too, yeah. It's
although
like,
Michael Albanese over there shamed me into giving up my happy pills. I don't take the happy pills anymore.
No, take
what?
Them.
I haven't taken them in over a week.
Oh,
that
great.
Makes sense.
That's why you're
yesterday
so sensitive.
Sense.
I'm not sensitive. Yeah. I'm having
that's
a great time.
That's why you're
time.
Saying lick my balls.
Wait, I didn't say. I never told
you
to you not take your
said,
happy
you
pills.
Said, you made a comment that stuck with me. What's wrong with being influenced?
Okay, maybe
being
influenced by what I said, but I didn't tell you you should stop taking.
No, people had told me when you're on those things. It was very little. It was Lexapro. It was 10 milligrams a day, teeny pill every day, but people had warned me that don't ever stop those cold turkey. And they didn't tell me what comes next, but I think of
like, Jameson and South by Southwest comes next, and that's where
I think Jameson's would have come in there anyway.
Yeah.
But I think the idea was that you're going to get all these suicidal thoughts or something. And because my doctor's office was closed, and I was in a 2 or 3 day period where I couldn't get them anyway. By the time I got to the third day, I'm like, well, I'm not getting suicidal thoughts, and
not anymore. For 3 days though,
I had a knife. Like
you were
this.
One hand hanging on the ledge of the top of your house.
Because I started to take them because a lot of things happened to me at once. You know, you know the old show and everything that went down there. My older brother died. One of my best friends died. All that happened in like 14 days. And my heart was kind of like beating strangely for weeks. And that's not happening anymore. So I figured, well, I took the drug. That went away. Everything, I'm cool. So as long as I'm not having suicidal thoughts, then I think I should be fine. But we'll see. Maybe maybe I shouldn't have quit cold turkey.
If you need to write a mantra, just let me know.
Well, you're good at it.
I might lose it.
We can lose them together.
Okay.
Also, you just handed all power to Michael. He knows he can influence you now, so you've just handed.
No, he made a point.
I feel bad.
I was wondering, because I believe me, I thought that they did a good job for me, and I would recommend them to anybody who
do something stupid. Then now it's going to go on record that it's my fault. I was the influencing factor.
He's the one who told him to stop cold turkey. No, but
he just walked into the deep end of his pool and never came out. Mike etched into his stomach.
You said, "Why don't you just be a man and take care of your problem?"
Right. I did say that.
But I was thinking that probably it takes the edge off, is what those things do. And in reality, if I went and worked out an hour a day, I'd take the edge off, right? So that was the reason I was thinking. Like, what am I just using a pill when I could take a walk to the park? Walk a mile a day or something like that.
You know what the reality is? If you just left your house for 15 minutes a day.
I was just South by Southwest for five days.
Before that, you've been
once a year, he opens the front door.
Listen, I'm changing my ways on that. There's a song on the new Neil Finn album that I love him. He was in Split Enz and Crowded House, and I've been following him. Guy's never had a down period, just written great songs. And he's got a great new album out. And on it, there's a song called Recluse. And it's kind of affected me. It's like really, it's really like, it's the people that you lose.
You know what you should do? You should come out to the Aurora Theater this Friday and or Saturday.
Oh, that scared the hell out of me.
Two shows each night.
There's a lot of people around. They'll touch me.
I have some symptoms of Lexapro withdrawal.
I'm getting better with these plugs, by the way.
All right, don't scare me now. This is WebMD, where you find out that everything is bad.
Yahoo
cancer.
Health.
Same thing.
Yahoo Health.
Same database.
It's all cancer.
Oh,
not
only is it not a medical specific, it's a dying website called Yahoo.
Go to Yahoo for all of your health information.
Right. But now this is by an MD who wrote this.
Oh, well.
Do you have flu-like symptoms, fatigue, nausea, difficulty sleeping, balance problems? I saw you a little unbalanced.
Yeah. I always have those anyways. I've had vertigo. I've had minor vertigo
Dizziness?
And daily headaches since I was 20.
Sensory disturbances? What
does that
mean?
A little bit, but I always have them.
What does that mean, sensory disturbances?
I think that's when you think you see or hear things that aren't there. No, that'd be a hallucination. That'd be an auditory hallucination. There's a dog in here right now, right?
I didn't hear a dog.
What?
I did, but I took Benadryl earlier. That causes me to hallucinate. It doesn't sit well with me.
So good to say suicidal thoughts or stuff like that? Because
being a dick.
What you worry about.
I'm just kidding.
I want to get back to that, too.
I have something to say on that, too.
What you worry about is, because what it does, and I have a friend who's in the pharmaceutical industry, or was. He's not anymore, but he was. And he told me that the thing about those pills is they don't really, really, really know why they work. But they turn off that. Is it serotonin? Which is the bad one?
Oh, yeah. It, like, blocks something or collects something.
Yeah, it's a blocker. They don't really know why it works. And so if you think about it, I think the reason they tell you not to stop cold turkey is because it's you're holding a hose back, and then all of a sudden, wow, a flood of negativity will come out of you.
Now, see, that seems like a bad idea to do in general, but it's sometimes a good idea. Like, you have to go to the bathroom really bad, and if you're at the urinal. Urinals is a place where guys pee. I just want to make sure that you're not
gonna make her cry.
I thought that was the sink.
I knew that.
And then, but you have to go, and you go a little bit, then you hold it back, and then you let it go. Like that feel, like relief feeling, is something pretty.
These are
incredible.
The pee games that men play, but by themselves.
Absolutely,
It's like, why let it go?
I'd love to play with other people, but apparently after middle school, if you play swords, you're considered a lunatic.
Yeah, you get stigmatized. Is what happens.
Exactly.
You know, back to your mantra.
It
reminds me of something. I always think that, like, if you ask me about my relationship with Autumn, I would think, we're just, like, great friends. We've known each other for a long time. I feel that I'm supportive of Autumn. I always feel. But now you got this mantra, like, all right, don't take it too seriously. So, and I remember remember that birthday party? I don't know which birthday it was of yours. It might have been 25. We were at a party. Mm-hmm. One of your birthday parties. It was pre-Travis.
Okay.
So the other guy was there.
Yeah.
The musician.
Uh-huh.
And And you were talking to me, and I said something to you. This was after we were done working together, the Mad Pundit thing. And one of your relatives said to you loudly, "Remember, he can't tell you what to do anymore." And in that, I thought, oh my God, she's been like going bitching to her family that I'm telling her what to do yelling at her. It's like, now I feel like that now with the mantra.
Oh, no.
I don't have any mantras for you. I don't have to deal with you.
Like I said, I wouldn't need this mantra, I don't think, if I wasn't pregnant, honestly.
Okay. All right.
Yeah. And that whole thing is probably just because you were my boss and now you're not. So it's like, I can't tell you what to do anymore.
And by the way, I may not have been your boss, but all of a sudden when it came time to pay for 800 people, I was on the hook for like $100.
What's that? For what thing?
Yeah.
For the birthday?
Oh, I wrote on my mantra never to bring that up to audience. It's not important, and I don't want to bring people down. No, I put in $100 that night.
Oh, thank you.
No, you're welcome.
Oh, no one thought you were on the hook for anything.
Well,
no one assumes
people
that.
People were looking at me funny. Like, you got the radio
you
money.
You weren't on the Lexapro.
Hey, none of the rest of us are on the radio money.
You did used to blow your nose with $100 bills. I think that's what people
had. You lit multiple hundreds
Well, I don't
that
do
night.
That anymore.
My friend T. Shaw joints with $100 bills. And then light them with $100 bills.
Well, my friend T. Shaw talks about that because like, when you're a writer, and he was a writer on some show. He's been a writer on Saturday Night Live. He's been a writer on Leno. He's been a writer on a lot of things. But he talks about that moment because when you're a writer, when you're gainfully employed, you're making too much money. And so, but then you get fired without any warning whatsoever. So literally, his thing is like you're lighting your cigar with a $20 bill, and the call comes that you're fired, and you're like trying to save the bill. Like, whoa!
What percentage of this has to be damaged?
That's what life in show business is like.
Well, the mantra for me was just a reminder that, you know, if something were to happen to me that I mention on the show, it would be like a joke and it would be funny and we would talk about it because we're a fun show, you know. But if it was outside the show, you would be very concerned and helpful and supportive. And that's that was just a reminder of that, you know.
I hugged you the
you
other
know
day.
She...
Of course. And like I said, intellectually, totally get it.
All right.
You know, but also I'm also feeling all these things.
I don't want to stress you out during your pregnancy. You'll have the baby like 24 hours too soon or something.
24 hours too soon?
It'll be a quarter of an ounce lighter than it's supposed to be.
I don't want a fat baby.
they're supposed to be fat. That means they're healthy.
Just kidding.
What are you putting society?
I'm trying to get to smoking. Fat? Trying to get smoking so that she doesn't live her life as a fat baby.
It's also easier for you if you're smoking.
That would be seven grams lighter, by the way, if you want to break it down.
Is that how it works?
I'm pretty good when it comes to certain types of math.
Here's that having to do with weighing marijuana.
Little measures, sticky measurements.
Yes.
I'd like to take credit for this enlightenment that Autumn's had, because I notice I'm very sensitive to this during the show, and I can see it's bothering her. So after the show, I call and I shit all over you. I say, Eric's being a real dick, misogynistic. He's old. He's closed-minded now. He thinks he's open-minded because he used to be open-minded, but he's not so open-minded anymore. He's living in the realization that one time he was open-minded. I'm just saying these things to help get her through this.
Okay.
That was all fake. I thought we had a real conversation.
All right, now Michael's going to have to call her and start shitting on you. This is becoming difficult.
I had to keep the show together, Autumn.
Thank you, Greg. You're the glue.
That's my, yes.
You're the glue that tears us apart.
That's right. Greg is the glue.
I suppose it will come up we could have covered it in news, but I want to bring this up. This movie, Noah, is it out yet? Russell Crowe as Noah?
I don't know if it's out yet. I don't think so.
There's a little bit of controversy in the right-wing world. Meaning Fox News and Hannity and, you know, every other AM radio show, whatever. I think Bill Maher's an asshole. Let me just say this. I don't agree with him really on anything political. And I think he could be kind of an asshole. The only thing I agree with him on is religion. It's the only thing that I see eye to eye with him. And I guess there's a big controversy going on because he mentioned that maybe he's trying to, I don't know if it's on YouTube or not, but he's talking about Noah. And in the thing, he said that this was... God is a mass murderer, you know, and everybody just sort of freaked out, you know. So how could you just say God is a mass murderer? And I watched on Fox News where this was outrageous. Nobody would take the time to actually debate the issue. Mm-hmm. It was just that here's something that just should not be said. By the way, we're a media outlet, and we're telling you this is something that shouldn't be debated. It shouldn't be said. And anybody who takes an opposing point of view is not only wrong and going to hell, that we know, mm-hmm. but they're bad people with a bad influence on the planet. So I was thinking about, first of all, do people who are Christians, and I know a lot of great Christians, and they're cool, and they do good things, do they really believe the Noah story literally, Or is it some sort of metaphor for other things? And if you do believe it, and I had never thought about this before until I heard the Bill Maher thing. So the world is sinning, you know, and the sin is so out of control that God just has to kill everybody and start over again, right? So if we buy that for people who are 18 and over, and that's nowadays, so let's say 13 and over, because you only live to be like 30 or something. So
right.
You cannot get around the fact that there were 5-year-olds, 2-year-olds, 7-year-olds, newborn babies. How is it possible that they sinned so much in their 7 years
right.
that they had to be killed?
Sure.
And if you saw a guy on TV who said, well, I had to kill everybody in the house because, you know, they were just all sinning.
Yeah.
And it's interesting to me that nobody will actually debate that. Either one. Do you mm-hmm. believe it literally? And if you do believe it literally, what is your justification for 5-year-olds and 3-year-olds being swept up in that flood when zebras are being saved? Because apparently they're important.
Well, I mean, do you take the word for word that it was an actual flood?
That's
and not
my
like
question.
A,
that's
know,
my question. That's my question to people.
Flood?
I
and first people... of all, if you think that Noah only took 2 of each, you're an idiot because it's believed that he was a Jew.
Yes.
So 2 for you, 2 for me. Like, it could have been more in there. You have no idea.
I like the fact that it's I like the fact that it's believed that he was a Jew.
2 for you.
There are rumors.
Well, he didn't have a rabbi. There was no synagogue. He was just they just referred right. to him as a man of God.
No
it
pork.
It just turned out that he was the only dude who wasn't sinning.
Right. Yeah.
The only one
on the planet.
But a little greedy he got.
But I would like to know. I would like to know from people. And I mean, sincerely. I'm not
sure.
talking about, you know, because, you know, I have my thoughts on these things.
Not a religious debate. Just
you know what?
What are the facts?
A, do you really believe it?
Yeah.
That it's literal? Does anybody really literally believe? Because that is a fairy tale. I mean, that's a fairy tale.
Well, are you talking about the Bible
like,
now? Just in general?
No, I'm not, but yeah, well, yeah, but this
Sorry.
Story.
This story in
Because,
particular.
You know, a lot of the Bible is just wisdom, right? It's just like, don't, you know, do unto others. And, you know, you can believe. The
Bible's got a lot of good shit in there, man.
Oh, yeah, but there's some weird stuff
in there,
too.
There is.
There's like one where the guy says, you can rape my daughters while you're here or something.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, yeah, of course, you're a guest. To rape my daughters, you know? So
please come in, have some coffee, touch my daughter. Whoa, what?
But there's
what was
also,
that second part? You said coffee, right?
Even though I don't believe the stories necessarily, there is a lot of wisdom in the Bible. There's a lot of human wisdom. There's a lot of, you know, I think, you know, do unto others as you would have done to your... I think that's... If you live that way, that's a great way to live. I don't care who you are or where that came from. That's wisdom, I think. If you are empathetic to others in the way that you live your life. But the individual stories is like when people go to church, do they really, really believe that whale one where like Jonah?
Jonah?
Yeah. Whales don't eat like that. Whales eat krill. They don't even open their mouths.
Yeah, they're
it was a sperm whale. They could swallow them.
They swallow a lot, them sperm whales.
But they open their mouths like, ow.
They open like that and eat things like that?
They filter, filter out the water and then everything else.
No, but
the solid
they actually have teeth. Okay. They're not
the
baleen.
The filter.
They're not the baleen. He was eaten by a sperm whale.
Oh, really?
Oh, I thought sperm whales had
Read
baleen.
The Bible, Hessler.
The word sperm is in the Bible.
Yeah,
how do you know it's a sperm whale?
Because.
Say sperm whale in the Bible. Find it. Find where it says sperm. They don't even say They always say like your seed. They don't even say
sperm. Yeah.
I mean that whole thing about not being not
spilling
master,
your seed on the ground.
Spilling your seed onto rocky soil or something like that where it can't take. And then supposedly that means no one's allowed to ever beat off.
Onto the ground.
By the way, what was Noah's time frame to build that?
I think
to build
he had,
and collect the animals.
I think, oh yeah.
He had like 20 days.
72 hours.
So I
was like a Liam Neeson movie.
I want you to Eric.
It was a Steve Carell movie, first of all, and it was to save government powers.
Oh, yeah.
That's where your knowledge is coming from.
Exactly.
Just go in your backyard and bring me 5 different species of animals,
right.
Male and female.
Yeah.
Just 5 of them.
It's going to take some time. And
Eric
you know,
would be washed away, by the way. I don't think any of us would be selected to be Noah.
We think of just animals like zebras and elephants and stuff, but it's every insect. It's everything.
He should have let alligators go.
Yeah, we don't need
Screw
those.
Them.
You know,
they would
choose.
Survive.
Choose crocodiles.
Yeah, they would survive themselves. Those are those creatures that don't ever go away.
Yeah.
Yeah, you didn't have to put fish in there, right? Because he's already, it's the ocean.
Yeah,
right.
The fish were like, yes.
Oh, this is our time.
Yeah.
Nah, but it was freshwater. If it was a flood, a lot of the saltwater fish, they got fucked.
Yeah. Well,
what
they were sinners. They deserved it.
So he had tanks, apparently.
Is the movie any good? I brought this up because the Pope canceled a visit with Russell Crowe.
Good, because Russell Crowe's a dick.
Oh, man, throws a telephone in his hotel room and you can't look. You've never done that?
There's something about his face that bothers me. Oh, that's true. But yeah, you know, people must think that it is literal because I see posts on Facebook where they're like, we found the Ark. It's in this mountain every once in a while.
There's a special on TV once.
Yeah. That, what is it?
Satellite imagery.
Right.
And there it is in the mountain.
In the mountain, yeah.
There was a movie or something when I was a kid called In Search of Noah's Ark that had a bit of buzz in the mid-70s or something like that. It was at Mount Era. It's got a weird name. Era Matt or something. Mount something that's supposed to be have a lot
of. Did he make
done.
The boat out of carbon fiber? There's no way that thing survived.
Well, God.
If the years are right.
You know, this is my thing that I don't understand about boats.
It's Godwood. Oh, man. Can you imagine the upsell on that at Home Depot? Can I get a couple sheets of God ply? Let me get some God ply. I gotta make this. I gotta do that.
Art
Jesus
compatible.
Christ, is it coming up?
If it's God doing it, why don't you just levitate everybody who he didn't want flooded?
Because there.
Why do you have to build a
there
damn
must
boat?
Be some metaphor. Why does it,
because
like,
it wasn't real.
Yeah. Okay. But I mean, just for purposes of discussion, why wouldn't he just like walk around the corner and God built you an ark? There it is. Blah. Why does he have to build the damn thing?
There must be some lesson to it, right? Like,
well, right, if you don't take it literally. Which
wait,
would
so if
be,
you're not a sinner, you are tasked with this complete burden?
Right.
Yeah.
I'd rather sin and die. I don't want to build a boat.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you. This is my this is my payment for not being a sinner is that I got to bust my ass and build this huge boat on land. Everybody's laughing at me. I'm building a huge boat on land. All my neighbors are laughing and think I've lost my mind. They think I've had some sort of Jameson South by Southwest revelations. Got me in my backyard building this thing. Put up with a lot of crap if you want to be a believer. Can you pull up the Noah trailer? Because I have no idea how they're even selling this thing.
So I did find some documentary about Noah's Ark, and the quote for it is, they found this big beam in Turkey, and it's not 100% that it's Noah's Ark, but we think 99.9% that it is.
What? The word Noah's on it? Well, this is wood from that time, so there's no way you would have wood at the top of the mountain unless the water had risen to the point.
Exactly.
That's their thinking, right? You wouldn't have a ship plank like this that high up in a mountain unless the water was once that high.
Right. It was
in a time where men made wood.
At an altitude of 13,000 feet. And that carbon dating suggested that it was 4,800 years
old.
Yeah,
how could it have gone to that elevation unless there was a flood, Eric?
I know.
But it lifted the boat
this
up.
Is why there I love. Were trees there.
This is why I love. 4,800 years old.
Which is about close to how old the Earth is, right?
6,000, I believe, is the official. Mm-hmm. What shouldn't that be enough for people to go, okay, we need a rewrite here. Okay, the King James Version is a rewrite. It's a, you know, it's not the Bible that we have is something that was put together by a committee in the 1600s as they decided which books were going to be in and which ones are going to be out and all of that. And so can't we do that again when we find obvious flaws in logic? Like, these people are using carbon dating. Well, keep on going with the carbon dating.
Carbon dating is made up.
You'll go way, way back.
Carbon dating is fake.
Well, they use science and the scientific language to say, well, right. Scientifically, we're going to prove that this was Noah's Ark.
Is that
there
science
crap
is real,
all over
though.
That wood because of that many animals?
That's real science. The science that you hear from scientists?
Oh, that's made
that's
up.
Made
that's
up.
The devil trying
yeah,
to.
Exactly.
Did you get the trailer?
I have it.
See, in a world where Noah builds a boat.
At a time when wickedness was great in the world.
Ooh. Unlike now.
So too was the response. Now it's showing the clouds rolling in.
God had a wicked response, y'all.
Noah's waking up. He sees the storm brewing.
He looks like the gladiator, doesn't he?
Oh, there's blood on the ground. He's stepping in it.
Why is there blood on the ground?
Are there no words in this movie? Oh.
No.
Stop it for 1 second. Pause.
Maybe you guys would stop talking
Noah,
over this epicness.
Did Noah just wake up from his bed like...
Yes.
Did he?
Yes.
Oh,
well, I don't know if you knew this, but Noah was actually Rumpelstiltskin before he became Noah.
Was it a dream?
Isn't that Rumpelstiltskin the one that slept for a long time? Like a bum?
No.
That's the one that
Rip
turned
Van Winkle.
Hair into gold.
Who was Rumpelstiltskin then?
Rumpelstiltskin spun...
hay into gold for that lady.
Yeah, something like that. Yeah, you're getting your...
Same. He was a Jew.
Yeah,
I think we got the whole thing together.
Welcome to Fairy Tale Week on the morning show. It's like our Shark Week. Yeah. We do it once a year.
We did...
Fairy Tale Week.
We did lots of... yeah. Grimm's Fairy Tales, yes? No.
So, okay. So go ahead.
He's going to destroy the world.
Wow.
Liam Neeson. Man corrupted his world.
Talking very
and filled it with violence. So we must be destroyed.
Yes.
All the whispering is coming.
We build a vessel to hold the innocent.
Mother!
Yeah, my family. Yes.
Them!
Shabang.
What do you want? Did you really think you could protect yourself from me in there? It's not protection from you.
Is that Liam Neeson?
I have made up my back. And you stand alone and defy me.
It's always Liam Neeson.
I'm not alone.
Oh, come. Here comes God.
Beautiful Icelandic scenescapes.
Yeah. Is that where he's from, Iceland?
Well, that's where they filmed this. All right, now it's showing.
Can I ask you something?
Yeah. I have a better soundtrack. Can I pitch a better soundtrack song for this, please?
He's going to hold up the iPhone to the mic.
In a world, I would build an ark for the innocent.
Where Noah was also left alone over Christmas this summer.
I would love to see Macaulay Culkin come back as Noah. Yeah.
You know, that guy died.
They made my world disappear.
Awesome.
That In a World guy died, or one of them.
Did he?
Just recently. But
there's plenty of them. It's like the voice of Bugs Bunny.
This is what
there's
I
a
want.
Lot of them.
Yeah, it's the guy after the other guy. Yeah. But how awful were people? Okay, they didn't even have the internet in Noah's time. Are you telling me that God got really pissed off back then when they didn't have the internet, the stuff that was going on? But now, the things that we look at on the internet, the things that are created.
Stop trying to find holes in creation, Eric. You're going to end up getting in trouble.
Wouldn't God be a little more pissed off the way people are acting now than then?
Would.
They didn't even have the means to get in that much trouble back then. Jesus, your entire village was like 100 people. How much trouble could you get into? People lived and died and knew like 50 people their whole lives back then. How much trouble how could you cause at that time?
It seems crazy that it would be thought of as literal in any way.
Somebody does.
Yeah.
I would like to hear somebody who does.
We'll have them on the show.
Yeah, we'll have them on the show and we'll give them their thing. The Pope canceled a meeting with Russell Crowe. The people from Noah desperately want to get the blessing of the Pope or somebody to quell people, you know, in any movie that's based on fiction, I mean, on a book, and any movie that's based on a book is not going to have everything in it. It's a 2.5 hour thing or something. And so people are kind of pissed off that doesn't tell the story the way they believe it should be accurate. So they're looking at the Pope to come in and bless it. You know, this Pope, he's like, everybody's cool. You know? So he can bless it.
I love movies.
I love movies. I love popcorn. God loves popcorn.
God loves you. Well, peace.
This Pope is so liberal that at one point he said that atheists can go to heaven.
Sure.
What a son of a bitch that guy is.
No, but I mean, that doesn't make any sense.
Who cares? I'll take it.
That actually makes perfect sense.
If there's a heaven, I mean, as laid out by the, there are rules.
He's still saying
to get
they're
there.
Wrong, but they're still welcome.
Right.
He's like, yeah, you're wrong, but we'll let you in the end.
Well, then why not just have a bunch of fun and die?
Here's what, in my mind, debunks the entire, you know, believe what you want to believe. But for me personally, believe if there is a heaven, let's assume there is, and say you worship something crazy, you worship a false idol, you die, and then you find out that there's a heaven. And you're like, oh my God, that was what was real. In that moment, in your soul, don't you think you would go, oh shit, okay, no, you're right, I'm down.
Yeah.
And then they're just gonna give you the middle finger as you go away, because back in that other the other form that you were in existence, you didn't believe this. But for the rest of eternity, you have to deal with what that 33 years, I'm assuming I'm gonna live to 33 years is you
it's
dealt with
liberal.
And you questioned? Come on.
Yeah. I know, it doesn't make any sense.
Well, there was
the idea that you could be a serial killer who repents on his deathbed, go to heaven. I could be an atheist and help a lot of people and be nice and kind and lend people money and things like that.
No,
and I go to
hell.
I mean, that just doesn't make
any
sense.
In hell, babe.
If you live your life in a good way, if there's a good energy and a dark energy, you know, just try to be on the side of the good energy, right? And then you'll be all right, I would think.
Sure. That's the South Park episode where the correct answer for
heaven.
You're
accusing me of plagiarism?
No. the correct
She's
answer.
She's accusing South Park of being the all-knowing.
They kind of are sometimes. People are going to heaven and they're like, oh, sorry, you can't get into heaven. You were the wrong religion. He's like, but I was a devout Christian and I helped homeless shelter, you know, did all these things. And they're like, no, the correct answer was Mormons. Yeah, the Mormons. And they were all just Mormons in there and all these Christians and Buddhists and all these people all went to hell.
The Mormon Church puts ads in the program of Book of Mormon. They're one of their biggest sponsors.
Which is insane, dude.
It's not insane because if you've seen the play,
sorry,
I didn't mean to cut you off, but if you've seen the play, at the end of the play, I said, I was like, maybe they're not all that bad.
Right.
Like, it was incredible, like, but I'm surprised, the twist and the turn they put on that.
I'm surprised that just the language alone doesn't scare them away. I mean, the language is I mean, that's what I'm surprised. So you got to say that they're pretty smart in the fact that they are able to kind of sort of ride it out. Take the joke.
Exactly.
And roll with
it. But listen, they would be even more criticized and ridiculed if they were if they were to come out against it.
They could ignore it, though, but they chose not to do that.
Absolutely.
But you know, my wife, when Mitt Romney was running, she was like, I'm not voting for a Mormon.
Aww.
So she was like, they're weird. You know, and I'm thinking,
that makes sense.
When's the last time you heard of a Mormon serial killer? Oh, yeah, the Osmonds. Boy, that we wouldn't want them running the country. That would just be debauchery.
Hey, Donny Osmond called Rosie O'Donnell fat on live television. I do not need
that. That is the most cruel thing he's ever done in his entire life.
It's true. I remember when I was a kid, I saw that episode, not to go on a Rosie O'Donnell tangent. But her show, I used to watch that show all the time.
She was the queen of nice until Tom Selleck showed up, and then boom.
Well, he was talking about Donny Osmond was on the show because she was like a huge Donny fan, and he said something about, oh, I have a helicopter and I go riding, and she goes, oh, can I go on a ride one time? And he said it probably wouldn't take off.
Whoa.
Something along those lines, and that was like, oh,
boy, Donny was edgy with his material that day, huh?
He was trying to break away from that.
And then a week later, he came out and sang Puppy Love in a dog costume. Anyway, enough on my Rosie O'Donnell.
Wow, no, I'm fascinated. Are there any other episodes you can walk us through?
I could do them all if you'd like.
You should do the director's cut.
Special episode of Eric Von Radio.
Deconstructing Donnie. We're going to charge $1.99 on iTunes for that one.
Was Steve Young Mormon? He played
Steve
for BYU.
Young, yeah, Steve Young's a Mormon. They all. Here's the thing about the Mormons.
I feel like they've hidden it, though. He doesn't ever talk about
the Mormons,
it. He doesn't preach. That's good.
The Mormons do not evangelize the way that Baptists do.
Mm-hmm.
They're very Jehovah's Witnesses over
which,
the top.
Which, just quickly, so they think there's only a certain amount of space in heaven, right? Yeah, they go
apparently,
around.
Apparently, at this
no,
point.
No, no, Jehovah's Witnesses. Oh. I just went on a tangent here because they go recruit. They knock on doors. Yeah. Hey, compete with me.
Well,
why would you?
But now, I get that. But if I were a devout Christian
anything.
Or devout anything, it would be, wouldn't it be my full-time job to save everyone?
That's how the Baptists are. That's why when you have a friend who says that you've known for 20 years, Autumn, I have something I want to talk to you about. That's being an evangelist. That's being a Baptist. You have a mission.
Yeah.
And
how could you sleep knowing
the rest of us go?
Happy,
oh, you know? No, they didn't get Jimmy. Oh, okay, there's another drinking guy I can take off the list. I'm not this guy's gonna be talking about his new best friend all the time.
Right.
And you know, good for him. Good for him if it helps him. I don't want to hear about it all the time. But in the Bible, there is a part about it's something about a lamp. You don't, if you have a flame, you don't hide it, you
let,
so that it can illuminate the ways for others.
Right.
I think that's where the evangelism comes from. The Mormons are very, like, they're very mission-oriented, and every one of them seems that they all do these missions and everything. They all are always wearing a T-shirt underneath. They have to. It's called a sitsi.
Really?
You know about that? Yeah, they all have to have the sitsi. If you're Steve Young.
During games?
Always
under
had to have
pads.
It on. Always
what
had to have
mean,
it on.
What do you mean, just any T-shirt underneath
it's a,
something else?
It's a T-shirt that's called a sitsi. I don't know everything about it.
Oh.
But I think it's just a T-shirt. And so that's their thing. So most people have to put stuff on their heads, like the Jews.
Yeah, yeah.
But see, the Mormons, it's their underwear. So they could, you know, they're not throwing it out there at you. But yeah, Steve Young had to go on a mission, I think, between college and pro football. You have to, after you leave, it's at a certain age, you have to go do your mission. Mm-hmm. But they're very kind of quiet about it. They don't really throw it in your face all that much. On the Jehovah's Witnesses, I don't know if this is true or not, but I had heard years ago that the population of the church is now more than what the scripture says the number of people in heaven.
They upped the number. I know there was a point they upped the number of people allowed in heaven.
Oh, really? Who
like,
decided that?
Oh, I made a mistake. I didn't carry that one.
Damn.
There's still limited space, they say.
And it's ridiculous. It's like 7,000 souls or something. It's not like something you could imagine. Like, all the people who have ever lived. If there's going to be a finite amount of souls,
right.
I think you got to get in the 100 millions, right? I mean, from all the time that all the people have ever lived. But it's something ridiculous, like 7,000 or something like
that. Well, when did Mormonism start? It started
This is Jehovah's Witness.
Oh, Jehovah's Witness. I'm sorry. I keep confusing those two.
Keep the craziness straight, for
sorry.
Heaven's sake.
Turning into me, now
that's
I remember what we
me.
Talked about.
That's what kills me. On like when the Muslims behead somebody and they're running around, you know, Allah Akbar, God is great, and they got the guy's head in their hand and everything, and they, you know, they think God's like looking down at that, going, "Hey, good show,
yeah, but you
show,
know what?
Way to go."
But you know what? That's devout.
Yeah, it is
that's
devout.
True.
But
they
my point is,
committed.
When it comes to the Muslim terrorist, I got to put up with their shit, and I don't even believe in anything. That's like a It's bad enough you're doing it for some entity that does not exist. You know, it's like you think somebody's looking down on you. And how twisted is that in any religion? Because let's face it, there has been moments of violence out of, except for the Mormons. No, in the beginning, Joseph Smith was murdered for having sex with everybody in the town or something. So how can you, I don't know. I'm confusing myself with all this. And then everybody's going to have comments, and I'm probably losing listeners. He doesn't believe in God.
You're losing Mormons and Jehovah's Witnesses.
Mormons and everybody. But if you believe... I have also met people who are strong believers who are some of the coolest people I've ever met. Like, because they really follow Jesus. You know, like, they really, it's really about living life in a good way and helping others and all of that, which is fine. I just don't happen to believe all those sort of storybook things in there, like Noah and Jonah and the whale. Did he get pooped back at? What happens to that? He gets thrown
How did
back
he get
I think he was barfed back up.
He barfed, he was barfed out.
Blech.
The sperm whale was just the depiction that people chose. It's not even clear if it was a fish or a whale.
Huh.
No one knows. None of it's clear.
I think it was in the Mediterranean Sea. Do whales even live in the Mediterranean?
Probably not. It doesn't even
Probably
matter.
Not.
It's like, you know, King Midas. It's the same story. If you put King Midas in the Bible, it would be something that people believed, right? They'd be like, wow, he turned to gold. He loved he loved money so much and everything he touched. And then he touched his daughter and she turned to gold. And if that wasn't just a story that we heard growing up and it was in the Bible, there would be people here who would yell at us and argue that King Midas was a real thing that really happened.
Mm-hmm.
There's no real... It's mythology.
Sure.
And mythology has a good place. There's things that it's
Lessons.
Done. Brings people together.
Yes.
You know?
I choose to worship Poseidon. And people think I'm crazy.
Have you Why been on Neptune? That Poseidon ride at Universal Studios? So good!
Why not Neptune? Why do you choose Poseidon?
Neptune.
Isn't it the same as...
No, yeah. Neptune's Roman.
Right.
Poseidon's Greek.
You go with
the Greeks. Yeah.
You go with the Greek mythology.
Yeah.
Which one has Apollo? Is that Roman?
That's Roman.
That was Rocky III.
I think I like the Roman ones better when I was a kid for some reason. Which one has Icarus? This douchebag who's so stupid he doesn't know that if he has wax on his wings and he flies too close to the sun that it's going to melt. Here's a guy.
No, here's the thing.
Here's
it's colder
guy.
Up there, by
here's
the
a
way.
Guy.
That's
here's
wrong.
Here's the guy.
That's,
hey. A guy. Hey, hey.
Whoa.
The
hey.
Physics behind it, it's colder up there. The higher up in the atmosphere you go, the colder it is. So
no, but
closer
he flew
to the
all
sun.
The way to the
no,
sun.
No, he didn't. He didn't go
understand.
Into space.
Have you not been watching
he
the
just
cosmos?
Went to the stratosphere.
It's not possible.
Maybe the ionosphere.
He went into space, and he went all the way to the sun, which is like 90 million miles away, and he should have stopped at 88 million miles, and he would have been fine. And then, after he got 90 million miles away and the wax on the wings melted, he fell all the way back 90 million miles to Earth.
First of all, it's 92.9 million miles to the sun.
Get it right.
Somebody's watching Cosmos.
No, or I have Google. Anyway.
For beginners, by the way, that show.
Did
I can't watch
see
it.
The second one? I haven't
yeah,
seen the second
for
one.
For beginners.
Is it bad?
Oh, get
no,
out of here.
It's for beginners. At one point, he's talking about the oceans on Titan. He's like, get this. They're not made of water. I said, yeah, they're made of methane. He's like, they're made of methane. I said, this show's for beginners. And I changed the channel. I'm done with it.
I loved it.
What
Finished.
Is the matter with you?
Finished. I don't need to watch that.
I've been,
teaching
Greg
me
and
nothing.
I've been watching these shows forever. We love these kind of shows. And we had our hopes up for Cosmos. I was out of town, and I didn't see the second one. I tried to look it up online. I couldn't find it. I wanted to watch it last night. Was the second one as disappointing to
don't
you?
Don't listen to
no,
Greg.
Don't listen to either of these people.
No,
Cosmos is amazing.
Look, we love
it. Do you know about the
I
DNA
the show,
cell structure of bears? You don't. And guess what? Cosmos explains it.
I do, actually.
Do you?
Well, explain
was,
it.
What strand of the DNA is it that created from a brown bear to a white bear, and why is it? Why did the? Why is the? Why will
that
the white bear
the,
survive?
This is the
that
game
was,
show I've always dreamed of.
The eighth rung in the DNA ladder.
First
That's
of all,
what it was.
There aren't eight rings.
Yeah.
They're infinite.
Idiot. No,
you're
idiot.
Just
infinite
idiot.
No.
Yeah, that part I made up.
You guys are taking it for trying to entertain you. But it is for beginners. It is for
it is
children.
For
it is not. You, we
right.
are not the audience.
And I got turned on by the first Cosmos
exactly.
when I was a teenager.
Yeah.
You know, so it's. I have to be careful with that because the idea is it's supposed to be for 13-year-olds and, you know, maybe.
It's also supposed to piss off the religious.
Did they do that again?
holy shit, everything they were saying was like they're presenting it as fact, which, you know, I believe is fact.
Well, these people that they killed. Science. Well, these people that they killed and stuff. You talk about those kind of stories, like, you know.
No, I'm just talking about like the origins of life.
He's like evolution is real. It is a scientific fact.
Yeah, absolutely.
And that, you know, it's
not a, that's not true.
Well, he said that just like the theory.
No, it's not a fact. It's a theory. It's a great, great, great theory. Well,
but he said just like the theory of gravity. Provable.
No, it's not. Hold on. There's a difference between a theory and a fact. If something is absolutely provable, it moves out of the realm of theory.
It can be its origins can be traced scientifically.
I believe with 100% of my fiber that evolution is true, but I do know the difference between a theory and a fact. There are big holes in evolution. Any great scientist will tell you that follows this will say there are anomalies, there are weird things, but there's also... It's a great working theory because you can do some predicting with it. It does make sense. It's probably the thing that has to do when you get to quantum physics and everything. Evolution is probably behind everything, I would imagine, not just life as we see it. But it's a theory. It's not a fact.
Well, they also
2 + 2 equals 4 is a fact.
This is what Neil deGrasse Tyson was saying. Is that
he's no Carl Sagan.
they played Carl Sagan audio last night or on the last Cosmos.
I wonder if there are people who are enlightened enough to want to watch the Cosmos, but they can't handle the fact that the new guy's black.
I tell you, he's a badass in this one. Oh, but
he's great. I've liked him for years.
He chased away a wolf
on the show.
Fire, yeah.
That was
the opening scene.
Is that the CGI wolf?
That was the whole thing. They put him in the wilderness.
Oh, really?
He was attacked.
Oh, is he still going through that brush and stuff from the first? That's what I didn't like about the first episode. Am I forgetting something about Carl Sagan? Did he walk through the brush and everything? Like, you know what I'm talking about? Neil deGrasse Tyson.
I don't think they took it that far. I mean, the graphics were terrible in the first one, but.
Yeah.
He didn't fight any wolves.
So you're saying Carl Sagan did not fight any wolves?
There's no confrontation with a wolf, Carl Sagan.
So, all right. I'm being distracted by Autumn and Michael doing something else. So. Let's
pulling back the curtain.
Every time I start talking with Greg, they get involved in their own conversation.
That's not true.
It's annoying to me. We're doing radio stuff. You're pulling it out
that no one can hear.
You point to each other's screens. Look at this. Oh, and just, you know.
I was asking, are we ever going to put up a shield?
Let me ask you something. If you're on stage doing stand up, and as you're in your rhythm, there's a guy standing there, and he's like going like this to his girlfriend about a beer and. Wouldn't that kind of affect you as you're trying
to
do
No, because that's what happens in comedy. People are ordering food. People are acknowledging stuff. People get up and go down to the bathroom.
We have to do it.
I'm a pro, Eric. I never leave my house.
I
know you've only been doing this for a few weeks now.
But you are a professional. Exactly. No, I got it. What were you... So it was important. So what was it?
I was asking, are we ever going to get to our guest?
He's not. He's a guest here just to watch us.
People are asking in the
there's the camera.
The social room.
Yes.
I thought he was going to be on the show.
Talk loudly so people know you're still here. People think you left.
Kyle, say hello.
Hello.
See, he's here.
Kyle's here.
People were asking him back and forth, like, is Kyle still there? Who's Kyle? No, where's he at?
Yeah. Did he get outed? He had to leave? Yeah.
He's here. You want to come over here?
Oh, no, I was just going to come.
Here he comes. Get your pools of money ready.
Wait, there he is.
I don't touch anything on the way out.
Yeah. No, that wasn't Bert Kreischer. He just looks like Bert Kreischer.
It's the machine.
Kyle's here to observe.
Oh, I'm sorry.
You should be trying to impress him.
I'm a fan of the show.
Yay, yeah, he's just a fan.
He's our first
guest in the studio as a fan of the show.
I see.
He's like a student auditing. Do I really want to listen to this?
Auditing the class.
Yeah.
He's not paying, but he's auditing the class. Exactly. Yeah. We probably should do some news, I'm thinking. I should tell people. People got down on me.
Yeah. Patreon.com.
What is that, Greg?
Give the show money.
How do they do that?
Patreon.com.
Where would they look?
Eric Von Radio.
Are there different levels and stuff they can get involved in?
Yes.
But you don't have to give $10, right? You can give one, right?
You can give 50 cents.
Can you really? I don't know if that's true, actually. But I think you can give...
You may be right. I don't know. You can give 50 cents. Dollar may be the lowest.
But as you once said, disembodied voice, you once said that if everybody gave a dollar, we would cure radio.
Well, we would make enough money so we can keep doing the show. I don't know if radio is curable.
But we'd at least have...
That's pretty bold.
Can you say open the... What is it? I can't do that, Dave. I always suck when I try to quote movies that I've seen 100 times.
I don't quote movies.
I don't either. Patreon.com. If you want to be part of our team, go there, check it out. I the T-shirts and bumper stickers were ordered yesterday by me.
Oh, snap.
I don't know how I'm going to pay for them. But I figure, you know, once they come, you know, I got them, right?
Yeah.
So, yeah. No, we got, we've, they're, so.
We're all required to put them on our cars.
Anybody who is going to, anybody who's given at the patreon.com, the, some of the different levels, you get bumper stickers, you get T-shirts. And Michael Albanese, as a matter of fact, is the man who designed this one. So if you don't like it, take it up with him. Autumn, what's in the news? Whoa, dude. Oh, holy. Also, with Jay Busby in 10 or 15 minutes.
Is it Busby?
It's Busby.
Busby?
Busby.
Busby. So that Malaysian airline, shocking, shocking revelation, still missing.
This was, what, now 9 days with this thing?
Something crazy.
This
I don't
is
know
insane.
How long it's been.
I was watching the...
It's in Vietnam. It's still intact.
Now they're saying...
It's in Vietnam?
Yeah, it landed in Vietnam. Right before it got to the border of Vietnam airspace, that's when it disappeared. I think it landed.
They don't have planes in Vietnam.
But
well,
here's,
they don't, yeah, where are you going to land it? That's the thing.
Here's the wild
the dirt
stuff.
Dirt runway.
Yeah.
Rice I don't pat- know how patties. They know this stuff, but apparently, I don't because sometimes they're still checking in with the satellite, even though they
it
turned
like
off this other
to the satellite right. or something. Yeah.
So apparently, at some point, they go up to 45 after all this stuff is turned off. They go up to 45,000 feet. Okay, you cannot. So what's going to happen there is the oxygen masks are going to fall. Right. I didn't know this, but I found this out yesterday watching television, where I get all my information from. There's only 15 minutes or so of oxygen in those things.
What?
It's not forever. It's so that you can get through whatever's
right.
going on. So,
15 minutes.
If you what could have happened? This is wild speculation, but you could have terrorists, right, who want a plane, and they have other things that they want to do. They with that plane somewhere down the line. So you get a plane. This was a 777,
uh-huh.
right?
Yep.
This is a big plane.
777-300, which is even bigger.
So if you go up to 45,000 feet, the things drop, the people put them on, 15 minutes later, all the oxygen is gone. A few minutes after that, everybody in the cabin is dead. Then it goes back down to 5,000 feet and runs below radar for a good long time. So you could kill everybody on the plane without firing a shot, land the plane somewhere, get rid of the bodies, and then if you are a terrorist organization, you got a plane. And the only problem with that is that there's all intelligence. Even Edward Snowden is saying, no chatter, no talk
right.
about this. Nobody's right. coming out and saying, we did this and this is what we want. And even if it's a long play, like we're going to use this plane next year to ram into a building somewhere or whatever, you would think that the intelligence services who are going through your email and my email would have picked up something about it, and they're being very candid and saying, we do not, there's nothing on the radar here.
Right.
So, well, that was one of the reasons, because they said, why didn't people try to call if the plane had been hijacked? People have their cell phones, and it is right. hard to get service because I've turned my phone on, even not supposed to sometimes.
Probably somebody turned on the phone and that's
you get
down the plane.
That's what it was.
Yeah, maybe.
There you go.
Lesson learned. But they're saying, why did no one try to call? And that's one of the working theories. They just killed them all
yeah.
by going up
well,
to 45,000 feet.
Right.
There's no reason for that plane. Why can transponders be turned off? What is the reason that can be turned off?
There shouldn't be. And also,
good pilots are banging it out.
And in the digital age, why? I understand when it was tape, but I'm assuming that the black box stuff is digital now. I'm assuming it only holds the last 2 hours. So if they turn it off 6 hours before they do whatever they do, there's no chatter. In the digital age, why? And it's audio, which is really, you can compress it to the point to where you would have to really have experts to even listen to it. You know what I mean? Why isn't that the whole flight? That seems silly to me that that's now still just the last 2 hours of the flight.
And do you think everyone on the flight had their phone off? I mean, people could turn their phone on and out of airplane mode or whatever,
right.
and then maybe that sent some signal somewhere and you could see something. No,
you don't get much service.
Well, that's what they're looking for. And they were over the Indian Ocean for a large stretch. They were way out of cell tower reach for a long time.
Yeah, but satellites and things.
Well, you know, if you have a satellite phone, that'll work, but your
right.
cell won't just go pick up a satellite. It'll
in the middle of the ocean, right? Just flying over the country. Here and there, you can get a signal sometimes because I've turned it on, and I have an app on my phone that's a speedometer.
It has to read
and
like
I just wanted
tower.
To see how fast we were going with right. the speedometer. So the speedometer goes up like 120 miles per hour, but it maxed out, and then it said in digital format, like 520 miles per hour. I'm like, oh, cool,
right.
despite the fact that I'm not risking anything, but people would say I'm risking the safety of the plane.
Well, they're now starting to drop that a little bit.
I think you are allowed
it's
to
not,
it on.
But, if you have, I don't even understand how that works. If you could be making a phone call, your cell phone, as you're flying at 500 miles an hour, that signal is skipping from tower to tower at an amazing rate.
It doesn't stay very long.
Right.
It sits there for a minute or two. Gone.
I mean, if you drive from here to the city, right? I mean, you're skipping over different towers along the way. But if you're going 500 miles an hour, so blah, 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 blah. So Courtney Love apparently found this plane, and nobody's listening to her.
Yeah, she was using this website that lets you see satellite images.
Oh, okay.
And she said,
I see her with her glasses, and she's okay. I'm gonna figure this one out.
On coke, looking at this, like, all right, I think this is it. It's just some picture of the ocean that has, you know, some sheen on it that she says is an oil slick, and that in the far left corner that you can see an outline of a plane.
Yeah.
But this is from 4 days. This image was taken 4 days after the flight was missing. So there's no way that
an outline of a plane in the ocean?
It was not even like an outline. It's just a thing.
There's just something there.
Something there. Just sort of something. Could have been like fluid. A whale.
It would, the outline of the plane would stick in the
ocean.
Yes,
absolutely. Right. As an oil slick.
it just hold tight.
It's been amazingly calm seas.
My favorite part is how in this picture she signed it. She signed the picture from Paint.
Oh, yeah.
She put the arrows. And
oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. She's got like little red arrows on there. She here's like what MS the plane Paint. Is. And what, yeah. does she, what does she say? Like, this could be it or something. What was her tweet? She like tweeted something.
Do you want to read it?
Go ahead.
I have it up. She goes, I'm no expert, but close up, this does look like a plane and an oil slick. And then she says, prayers go, blah, blah, blah. But my favorite part of this whole thing is all the, because this is on her Facebook, which by the way only has like 300,000 likes. Like, goes to prove that nobody gives a shit about.
Seems
Courtney
very low. Is it her? Or
it's
her.
Hers. It's
not whole.
Yeah, yeah. No, it's her. And then the comments on this are brilliant. This is, what are the odds? What are the odds that the plane will be right next to a red sign saying plane, let alone next to the arrow? And then this guy named James goes, swear to God, if Courtney finds this fucking plane. There's one on here at one point that's my favorite thing I've ever heard. It says, none of this would have happened if Derek Zoolander just would have killed the Malaysian prime minister.
Oh,
exactly.
<yeah.
laughs> Exactly. I don't know. It's just, it is really bizarre. I mean, I still, in my mind, I feel like the thing just fell out of the air, and it's just a big world, and it's hard to find. But it is weird when you hear that it went up to 45,000 feet and then back down to 5,000 flying below radar.
But
that's
now, how did they know that it went up to 45,000 feet if all of the transponder stuff was turned off?
I don't know. Maybe the pinging of the satellite or something?
The engines transmit, too. I don't know what the information is being sent, but there's a lot of things in the plane transmitting.
Yeah, so... And because apparently the last thing the guy said, I didn't know that they did this as they were going to the tower. He said goodnight to the guy. And then everything turns off. Then they lose him.
Then there was something, what was it? There was something that said that there was signs of trouble, whatever they've found so far, because there's not much. Before he said goodnight. So he
right. Well, now they're, to now say they're listening
against
that,
his
that's,
will.
That's the last
the sequence
thing.
Of events before the final radio call was made. Are saying that one or both pilots were either involved in the plot.
Right. Well, here's the thing. Well, it couldn't be both. They're thinking it couldn't be both because those two guys couldn't request to work together on the same day. I guess when you're matched with the other pilot. They don't tell you 2 weeks from now you and Jimmy are going to be together. You find out pretty much that day the pilot that you'll
be
working with.
I think
you
can request, but the thing was they didn't request.
They didn't request.
There was no request.
So that's fine. Why don't you just wait until the numbers are right and you get with your dude?
I mean, that... It's a possibility.
You're like, all right, I guess we're doing this on our trip to Malaysia.
All right, that's, but I mean, that's the
or wherever we're going.
Okay, that's a possibility. I mean, everything's a possibility. I'm surprised that Michael, who's the king of conspiracy theories, doesn't have a.
This is a tough one because there's so much. There's so much information pointing in so many different directions. You know, I don't think it just hit the ocean. Everyone's dead, and they're just looking for the wreckage. Something fishy went on for sure. I think the plane's still around. I think it landed somewhere. I think they either offed everybody or got everybody off.
Right.
Probably well, killed everybody.
Those people are dead. You can't if you're stealing a plane like that. I mean, somebody's gonna run and do something.
I'm a fan of the follow the money theory too. Like, mm-hmm. there was somebody on that plane that needed to be dealt with, and they dealt with
it. Well, that's kind of crappy for the other 220 some odd
yeah,
people
but it's
that happened to be on that plane.
Yeah, well, you know what? Don't get on airplanes with powerful people. Why was it that? First of all, why is a guy that's that important that needs to die? Why is he flying commercial?
Exactly.
You know, it's like when you see Brad Pitt on a commercial airline. It's like, what are you doing? And there is no the only way that Brad Pitt should be flying in an airplane is if he's flying the airplane.
Yeah,
like that's the only. Otherwise,
yeah, he should be next to Travolta.
Yeah. Otherwise, you should be in your own, you know, G5 or G6 or whatever.
Well, it's expensive. It's mightily expensive to fly all the time.
Brad Pitt.
Yeah, that's not.
Have it worked out your contract.
Warren Buffett money and Brad Pitt money are two different. They're still in different universes.
I don't know.
Kyle
if you
can
know
tell
how,
you that.
I don't know if you know how cheap
isn't
it is.
Isn't it true? Rich people, you can't just fly around all the time. You'll be broke.
Jets and stuff. They
right.
Get away with it, but to have your own plane and
Yeah. No, but to lease a private jet.
Yeah. But for charter every time it? You lease a private jet every time. Even, look, rich people get rich because they don't waste their money, usually. It's not like us. Like, I get money. It's like, oh, hey, I'll do that.
Dude, I had an extra $200.
That's where your money went.
Yeah, they do, but not like Warren Buffett.
No. I had an extra $200 in my account one time, and I upgraded to first class going from LA to Atlanta because I'm dumb.
Okay, look, I know that's a pretty long flight, and you're a big guy, so absolutely. Upgrading is not a bad idea. I went up to the economy, not from economy. I paid the $30 flying.
I think it
to
is called
Austin.
Economy.
Well, yeah, from economy to business on Delta.
What's the difference?
Can I tell you this? Never take seat 10A. I can't remember which kind of plane this was. I actually love the plane.
Did you shit it?
No, no. It's because what they do is, you know that little area? You know that area where first class is over, and then you walk, and then you're in the different classes, right?
Sure.
Well, they've made this
the less classes, you
yes,
mean.
Yes, the lesser, the plebes. So the first one, 10A, juts out into the aisle, and you have to kind of move around it to get to the rest of the cabin. And so if you sit in 10A... the entire flight, they're moving snack carts and everything comes around you and smacks you in the knee.
Oh, because you're in the aisle seat.
You're basically in the aisle seat, but they change the aisle move. So you're, right. At the point that you're the first seat in the aisle, you're actually in the way until they go around you. Just don't get 10A. This is my tip to you.
Are you team aisle or team window?
I usually like windows.
Yeah.
Windows are great because you
team
can
window all the way.
You can. People won't talk to you if you immediately put your head against the side and act like you're sleeping.
Or if you just fall asleep on a large black woman's shoulder like I typically do
did,
on an airplane.
As you did. And now you have to fly with her everywhere you go because it's the
good
comfort.
And because we're dating. I'm not going to leave my girl at home.
No, why should you?
She should go to all the shithole clubs that I find myself in.
Get Busby on the line if you could, and we'll do a story or two more, and then we'll talk to our friend Jay Busby.
Brad Pitt is worth $240 million, by the way.
That's it?
Nothing.
Dude, I got a Mega Millions ticket that I'm going to be taking.
What about Angelina Jolie?
What is she worth? She gives
$145 million.
Yeah, so together they got a couple bucks, but look up Warren Buffett. You want to see really rich people? These people don't even have a billion. Bill Gates is $140 billion or something. That's insane.
What's not?
Yeah,
he
should give me. He should give me some of that.
They worked hard.
I always want to write a letter to Bill Gates.
If Bill Gates on Patreon donated $10, would you be offended?
Yes. Yes. $10. He would not make the credit list. He would not make the credit list. I would be offended.
Warren Buffett is $58.2 billion.
Which makes him nothing compared to Bill Gates.
I actually dated.
Who? Oh, yeah, they're giving all their money away. How about this?
Wow.
How about this? Warren Buffett's giving all of his money away after he dies.
I dated Warren Buffett's granddaughter and dumped her because she had weird toes.
Is that
true?
No.
Oh, my God, I really believed you.
How would I ever get in the same circle as Warren
Buffett's
granddaughter?
Yeah.
I was hanging around with Peter Noon's daughter this weekend. It happens.
I saw Peter. I love Peter Noon.
Right? I was hanging around with his daughter all weekend long. She's really talented.
Really?
She's
I believe you.
She's talented. She has a beautiful voice. She's a singer. She's about 27 years old. Natalie Noon. So this is a cool thing that happened to me at South by Southwest.
I might be related to them because my mom's maiden name is Noon.
Huh?
Ooh.
With an E at the end?
No.
Oh, I think they're with an E at the end.
They can change it.
Yeah, they can change it.
Hollywood. Add an E's.
No, so here was a cool thing that happened at South by Southwest. Two things that happened. Once, I accidentally slapped Mike Mills Mariam in the face. That was one thing. And the other thing was I was in a picture with Natalie Noon that was posted to Facebook, and then Peter Noon liked it. I got liked by Herman's Hermit.
That's fun.
That's awesome. So I don't know where that goes, but, you know, what the hell.
This is what your life's become. The likes on Facebook
I got liked by Peter.
Your will to live.
Come on. I got liked by the guy lead singer of Herman's Hermits.
I think that's cool.
It's a lovely adult.
The old Eric would have been excited about Mellow Mushroom Pizza.
Now I need the children of famous people to satisfy me.
Yeah, Natalie Noon is a very attractive female. I'd like to put an all call out to someone to give me her phone number.
No, she's great.
And I'd love to take her on a date.
She's a beautiful voice.
Busby's on. We have another new story. Or going to
what's the plan?
To Jay.
Let's do one more. You want to do one more?
Make it a short one. Don't do the space one.
Can't do the space
one.
We already talked space.
Yeah, can we talk about Miley Cyrus?
Yeah, because Wayne Coyne's involved.
So Wayne Coyne from Flaming Lips and Miley Cyrus are doing a cover of Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds.
And first of all, people are like, every story I've read about this is, warning Beatles fans, you're going to hate this. Can we hear the song? I mean, Wayne Coyne's involved. He's in Flaming Lips. They're psychedelic. Maybe it's pretty good. You know, warning, Beatles fans are going to hate this.
Yeah.
Miley Cyrus doing a cover of Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds. a song about tripping that John Lennon refused to admit was about tripping.
Yeah, I don't see what the big deal is.
Julian brought he brought home, remember he said John Lennon, it's obviously a song about tripping.
Right.
And John Lennon was always, well, no, Julian, my son, drew a picture. Okay, maybe he did draw a
picture.
Right,
but you were also tripping
your
balls off.
But you were also tripping
your
balls
time.
Off, and you were describing, you know,
exactly.
plasticine porters with looking glass ties.
What the heck is he talking about?
Newspaper taxis appear on the shore.
What
waiting to
so he's,
this is this, these are taxis that are made of newspapers who drive up on the shore, and they're waiting to take you away.
Cellophane flowers
of yellow and green towering over your hand.
We should make our own remake of that song.
Look out, Beatles fans. You're going to hate this.
That's
Eric
right.
Von Radio has remade Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds.
It's all about, it's just that Miley Cyrus is involved and that she's...
Well, Wayne Coyne, if you follow, and if you don't like the Flaming Lips, follow Wayne Coyne on Twitter.
You'll get to see some nudity.
Now his new account is Wayne...
Doesn't fuck girls or something.
I mean, Wayne Coyne.
Underage girls or something.
Well, he was shut. That Twitter account was shut down, right? Because he was posting too much nudity
on
Twitter.
Yeah,
and you know, and his taste in women.
No,
he
on Twitter.
But I know, but
he's gotten creepy. He's going after underage kids now.
Kids?
I mean, yeah. I don't know. Sometimes
I'm exaggerating.
His eye for women. You sometimes don't know if they're 17 or if they're 22. Or I mean, he really does. You know, he likes that set.
Sure.
And that's why his wife left him, finally.
Did she leave him? He left her.
He left her?
Yes.
Oh,
that's why.
That's right for the other girl.
I feel like his ego has exploded, and I don't care what they do with their music now. It's his art. He earned it. They did their albums that were a success commercially.
Right. And now they're going more
artistic.
And he
can do whatever he wants at that point.
Right.
But I feel like it's gone to his head, and he's just out there,
Did you tell
stalking
me
the young women, which I guess is fine, but with Wayne Coyne, this enlightenment seems fake now, too. It seems...
Yeah,
produced.
It's just a way to get in somebody's pants. At the end of the day, all of this, you know, stuff is just a way to get into young girls' pants.
That's what it was from the get-go.
That's the whole thing. Well, I saw a picture once where, because he used to, there was one tour where everywhere he went, he would round up, you know, good-looking women. They all had the same look. By the way, Autumn, you're right in his wheelhouse.
What?
Autumn was
on stage once, right?
Yes, she was.
Yes,
she was chosen to be one of the people jumping around because she's got that look. She's got that Wayne Coyne Flaming Lips look.
Well,
that
I was also wearing
pregnant.
A pink... wig and
but I mean he likes
dressed like Yoshimi.
He likes hippie chick looking girls.
Yeah.
And so on one tour he would go recruiting girls in the crowd before the show to get naked on stage with him. And if you look at these pictures where he's recruiting, it's like she 18, she's 17, she 22. What is she? And then he's like all gray hair and everything. But I love him. But he does this. When he shows up to do recording, he's always like taking these little, and he makes me crazy because he doesn't use the landscape. He does that thing with the little video where it's up this way. And when he did something with Kesha, there was a bag of meth laying around. And so now he did that while recording here, and she's getting stoned, and she's rolling a joint.
Yeah, they're rolling a joint.
And so people are, you know,
she's
whatever.
Showing off her lip tattoo, which is fake.
Is that online? Is that not been released? Not been released,
right? No.
So there's
not
no place
yet.
To find
What's
it.
Been released? The song?
The song.
No. I don't think so.
Oh, my God. Miley Cyrus is doing drugs while singing the song Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds, which is the only way to listen to the original song and how the original goddamn song was created.
Yeah, it seems like a big
Anyone
hubbub.
Anyone who hates Miley Cyrus for anything she does sucks.
And first of all, I knew
she's doing everything that everyone does to create music, and the only difference is that she used to be on Disney. If she was never on Disney, no one have a problem.
I feel like that's the same
17
thing with
million albums worldwide she's sold. If nobody likes her, then that's not
her
then
songs
that's not
are catchy.
Happening. I don't get
no,
it.
No, I give it to her. Unlike Bieber, she's working, she's doing concerts, she's pleased, she's doing a thing, she's got a whole
Bieber
thing
works
on.
Too.
Yeah,
that's what I was
going to
say. It was the same thing about
Now the reviews on Bieber are like within the last year or so, he's losing energy on stage, he's not focused. She's focused on what she's doing. She's a pro. I'll give it to her.
You'll give it to her.
Actually, I find it kind of skanky. She's not really my
Wayne Coyne already has. Which I still can't get over the fact he's shooting vertical instead of... He made that great movie, Christmas on Mars.
Oh, yeah,
it was brilliant.
That was a great
movie. Masterpiece.
That was a masterpiece of nothing.
That
was one of the best
films.
Worst films I've ever seen in my life.
It only took him 8 years to finish it.
Didn't he shut down the airport in Oklahoma? Because Greg and I love Flaming Lips, and so does Autumn. And so for years, we've kind of followed them. And by the way, as soon as she showed up with those furry things... On MTV, when I said I knew that there was a Flaming Lips connection. I knew she was being turned on by this because it was obviously that way she was going. But Greg had fallen out of love with Wayne Coyne because He left his wife, and
well, they were never married, but
well, you know what I mean. But they were together for a long time, and then he just started acting like an asshole. You tell me a story about him shutting down the Oklahoma airport.
I think he had a grenade that had been deactivated. It was painted gold.
Right.
It was just
so it's
something
like a peace grenade.
Yeah, someone handed it to him at a party, an overnight party he was attending, and they said, "Here you go, Wayne. Take this." And he went straight to the airport and had that in his bag. Took it through security.
They shut down the airport for an hour. And Wayne Coyne never apologized to other people who was like, well, you know, whatever. He never thought, you know,
it would cause any problems.
If you're Wayne Coyne, you're like, isn't it cool? I just shut down the airport for an hour because that's this experimental thing, you know.
It was Oklahoma City, so I can do this. This is my airport.
Yeah.
That's why he doesn't leave that city, because he owns it. I mean, outside of Kevin Durant really has taken over.
Right.
The one time he was in Oklahoma City. That guy's jersey's everywhere.
Yeah.
So Wayne Coyne maybe detests Durant.
But you're right. Wayne Coyne from Flaming Lips is the Bruce Springsteen. What Bruce Springsteen is to the Jersey Shore is what he is to the entire state of Oklahoma or Oklahoma
City. Except he actually lives there.
Well, yeah, he does live there.
Right.
In the same stupid little house with a bunch of crack dealers around
him. No, okay, he lives in that huge brick building.
I know, but have you seen the neighborhood around him?
Yeah.
It's all crack
dealers.
Yeah,
he's buying up a lot of those houses.
Yeah, I'm not buying his story, by the way. That documentary is awesome, and I stole a few cues from it when I made my documentary. That is an awesome documentary, Fearless Freaks. Anybody should watch that movie. It's great. But I'm not buying his story that he doesn't get high. I think he's not saying that so much anymore.
I don't know why he even ever went with that
story. I mean, you listen to the music on the new album. I mean, yeah. I don't know how the hell you're supposed to. I mean, how you could say that that's a person that's a teetotaler putting that out? You got to be kidding me. The guy's got wires coming out of his body and he's holding a baby doll. And I mean, come on.
But when was that documentary made?
Early 2000s.
Is it on your shelf?
I think it's over there. I'm sure that he has changed his ways.
Yeah, well, he used to get, but somewhere along the line, he started getting high. Hey, let's get a little Jay Busby in here, huh?
We have to finish the news.
Did we finish the news? I don't even think we gave you the stinger going in. Did we?
Yeah, we did.
That was the news. If you want to see some more blah 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 blah, ericfunradio.com.
You ready? the pregnant
I was
lady.
Up for this guy.
Okay. Jay Busby from Yahoo Sports. Can you hear me?
I can hear you, sir. I can hear you just fine.
I'm sorry that I said you'd be on at 10, and now it's 10:23 or something. I've been hanging around the whole time listening to us talk about the Flaming Lips.
You know, I never got the Flaming Lips. I mean, I know that you've been a big fan. It just has never clicked for me. It's like Neil Young. Everybody tells me I should, and it just doesn't click.
Well, the voice, you got to get over the voice. But Yoshimi and the Pink Robots, I think, is a good place to start. The best album is the Soft Bulletin, but I don't know if that's the best place to start. Probably Yoshimi battles the Pink, is that what it's called? Versus, whatever. Yoshimi, that's the one.
He's given up.
Well, I don't know.
It's really done.
It's Yoshimi versus I know we got to do a second show, too. Yoshimi versus the Pink Battle Robots.
Want to fill him in on him?
Yoshimi versus the Pink Robots or something like that.
What?
She couldn't even finish the signature end. Do you have it? Pull it up a little bit, and we can play it underneath. It's Jay Busby. What the hell is the brackets are filled out now? Did I miss my chance?
Yeah, you know what? I was going to lead with something that just absolutely goes perfectly with the Flaming Lips, and that's crazy-ass NASCAR fans.
Yes. So, I am both. I overlap.
Did you hear the story?
Okay, hold on a second. I missed the last race. I've heard no stories, so fill me in.
Okay, well, the last race, this has almost nothing to do with the last race. It was Bristol, Carl Edwards won, rain delay.
Yeah.
We're done with that. The story of this is a young lady from Tennessee named Stephanie Faye Hammond, who was so pissed that her husband was actually watching the Bristol race, and in her words, worshiping it, that she drove her car into a church, and then when he came to rescue her, she stabbed him with a kitchen knife. This is absolutely true.
Wow.
So it makes a lot of sense, doesn't it?
So did she have a problem with the church as well?
She went to the church as a form of refuge. Her husband is okay. I think that's the biggest and the best news out of this.
Yeah, because we don't want to lose a NASCAR fan. Okay,
I feel
good.
They're dwindling as it is, so we need to hold on to all we got. But a few of her quotes. God told me he wanted me in there. This is referring to the church. So I drove my car through the front doors. God told me to do it, so I did it.
Yeah.
And then when her husband came, when Stephen, her husband, came to check on me, I told him the devil was in me, and I stabbed him in the heart. Have you heard if he's dead or not? So he was not, but the young lady appears to be a little bit, maybe taking church a little bit too seriously and NASCAR not seriously enough.
Yeah, I think that, I mean, you can say
what's
what
the
you
difference,
want.
Busby?
Hey, that's right. It's all religion, NASCAR, church, all of it.
Exactly. Well, and then this is her Stainer quote here. I smoke a bunch of weed. I love to smoke it. Boom. Sometimes when I do, I start seeing things that others don't. Isn't God good? He told me that this would happen, and just look, I'm okay.
Well,
so
wow.
There you go.
Was it no? I think when God told you to go in that church, he didn't actually say take the car in with you, did he?
Right,
she
right. Yeah,
that's gotten out of the car.
When you go for communion, you leave your car outside.
Yeah, I think more of a strolling.
She treats God like idiots that listen to Tom Tom. It said turn left, man. I don't know. Right. I don't care going to a Burger King front window.
It said turn left. I'm in there. God. That's her GPS. God.
God's GPS, exactly. So
Noah.
NASCAR fans just never fail to entertain us. They are without a doubt the best fans. College football fans.
Surprisingly, though, it's the NASCAR drivers that fail to entertain me.
Oh,
well,
should we make the way so that you can make the hackneyed reference to left turns only?
No,
come on,
it.
So it's right
there
for you.
I came up with my own little one right there. I don't need to do it. You forgot. I'm professional.
These people who just don't understand the beauty of an automobile race. They're below me. It's okay, Eric. Your mantra. Michael is an a-hole.
3, 2, 1, 1, 2, 3. What the heck is bothering me?
Breathe it out. So what's going on with the am I too late to fill out a bracket if I wanted to? With the
No. You got till Thursday. They've got these little play-in games, but that doesn't mean anything. There are, you know, the number one seeds are Arizona, Florida, Wichita State, and Virginia. So there's plenty of time to fill out brackets. There's a lot of opportunity. There's no clear-cut favorite this time around.
Right. Is Wichita State a real thing? Or have the people that they've played, they're undefeated, right?
Right.
Have they played people like they're about to see? I mean, are they the real deal, or are they just going to get swept out of here because they're in a different class now?
It's a little bit of everything. They are the real deal. You know, you don't go undefeated anywhere without having a lot of talent. But the NCAA did them no favors. They've got to go through Louisville and a bunch of other teams that are just going to brutalize them. So they've got a very, very tough road. It's the bracket that they're in. They're saying it's the toughest ever. So, yeah, I don't think we'll be seeing Wichita State in the finals. I'd be very surprised. Florida seems to be the kind of the consensus favorite. But yeah, it's wide open.
What happened to my Orange Men? Syracuse Orange Men were on fire. They were going crazy. I was so happy, and then all of a sudden they just fell off a cliff.
Exactly. They flamed out early. Jim Boeheim, he
turns out they were acting green. Somebody kill me.
That's the man who invented beard bars.
Yes.
So go ahead. What did they just? They were getting lucky in a lot of games and winning at the last second, and then that just luck not only ran out but turned around on them. Now they stink, right?
Yeah. Well, I wonder. You know, I wonder how Jim Boeheim's coaching style works with the youth of today, because he's just he's just an a-hole.
Yeah.
You know, and I think that kind of old school arrogant top-down coaching just doesn't work anymore.
Right.
And I'm not going to go on some old guy rant here, but
why not? We're old guys. What's we do? We rant about these young
kids.
There's
just different ways to coach. You know, there's just different ways to coach. And the farther distant that you get from your players, I think the more the less that you have in common with them, and you know, the more you start using phrases like the Twitter and things like that, and that just does no favors whatsoever.
And they had to get rid of that one assistant coach that was molesting kids. He was probably good, and they had to get rid of him. After the
allegedly, I think that was pretty well blown up, but that happened right in the wake of the Jerry Sandusky.
Yeah, they were like, the whole Penn State thing was going on, and just to any kind of thing that came over this guy's like, oh, I think he touched a couple people too. Okay, goodbye, you're fired, get out of here.
Oh, that was awful.
Boeheim's been the longest running coach, right? I mean, he's been since I was born. That guy was the coach of. He's been there since the early '80s or mid '80s, at least.
At the very least, I don't know his exact tenure, but he's right up there. Yeah. I mean, he's an institution there.
Anything else I should know about in the world of sports, Jay Busby?
In the world of sports, let's see. We've got Jim Irsay, the Colts owner, was pulled over Sunday night, actually Monday morning, was suspicion of DUI, found with all kinds of pills in bottles that they didn't seem to originally come in. So he's in a whole world of trouble because he's claimed that he's sober and he's claimed that his life is in order. But he's kind of the Mark Cuban of the NFL. He's a guy who goes out, talks to fans, gives things away on Twitter all stuff, and he's insisted that he's sober. He's insisted that he hadn't had a drink. But what's going to be interesting is to see how the NFL cracks down on an owner, because they love, you know, throwing punishment down on players who misbehave. How are they going to react to an owner who has a franchise with a net worth of about $1.6 billion? So.
Yeah, well, he can afford whatever they're going to charge him.
Cab, that's the thing.
That's always the deal. And that guy, Jim Irsay, with I don't drink anymore. And meanwhile, you're looking at like this gin blossom nose. He's got that kind of skin that says, I've been up all night, you know, and he's professing sobriety. So, he's better than his dad, though, right? People don't hate him the way they hated his dad, who owned the Baltimore Colts, right? Was it his dad who moved to Colts?
And that the whole family, you know, they've gotten all kinds of grief for that, from you know, spiriting away the Colts in the middle of the night and all that.
So and that's why Ursay is kind of his son is kind of a man of the people, right?
Right. Yes. Okay. Kind of trying to avoid that same sort of you know, hanging in effigy stigma that went along with his dad.
This always happens. Like Bill Polian, who was the GM for the Bills when they went on their run, and then he's the GM for the Colts with Peyton Manning in that period of time. That guy, every time I saw him at a Paul Simon show in Buffalo, coming around the corner with, I don't know how he was able to handle six beers in his hands as he was coming around. And there's a guy, Bill Polian, you look at his face, you know, a lot of liquor went in those lips. Some guys just, especially the guys who are like redheads or whatever, their skin's so white that any drinking, it just becomes so obvious. You can see like red things in their face. But hey, apparently it works because they're both pretty good at what they do for a living. So let them keep on drinking. Catch a cab. All right, Busby, I'm sorry I made you sit around and listen to us drone on and on for so long. We respect you.
My man.
Do you offer this apology every time?
I do. Because I text him the night before and go, hey, Jay, you want to do 10 o'clock tomorrow? And he's always so nice. Yeah, absolutely. And then it's like 10:20 when I get to him. I have a conscience, you know? I want people to be happy when they're associated with me.
All right, next time I'm not going to let that happen.
No. I didn't want to stop talking about Cosmos or whatever stupid thing we were talking about.
Jesus.
Jay Busby. You basically, if you go to Yahoo Sports, Jay covers all kinds of things, and you'll see his byline, Jay Busby, and you can follow him on Twitter. Where? How do you do that?
JayBusBee. So it's going to be all NCAA tournament and assorted jokes and one-liners and puns for the rest of the week on that.
No, your Twitter's great. Jay Busby, Yahoo Sports, thanks for joining us.
Sure thing.
Well, keep all hands and legs inside the car because this roller coaster is coming to a stop, I believe. We're just about done with this here show. Enjoyed it.
Yeah.
Kyle, did you enjoy it?
Absolutely.
I saw you yawning a couple times. Please tell me you're just tired. You have a guest in here, and he yawns a couple times, and you think, I don't know, I'm doing it right? Just say whatever you're going to say.
Why?
Because it annoys me when
you
do that.
We can try to communicate without having to get
stop
on the mic.
Stop the show.
No, there's these things that you can open up on your computer.
Eric will stop it for us.
You can go, you know, you can talk to each other on your computer.
I think the music should be louder.
Well, it's got lyrics though, so I'm keeping it a little low.
I could sign it to
Eric.
You.
All right, wrap up the show.
Autumn.
See, this is the thing
Fisher.
You sign. It's not like Greg interrupts you and says, Eric, wrap up the show.
Yeah, but see, then I know. He's telling me to wrap up the show.
We got to handle each other differently. I'm a good manager. Yeah. I manage you different than I manage him. He needs his hand held.
Yeah, I am like that. I need people to. I'm pretty good. I'm pretty talented, but I don't like distractions.
All right. I'll do this next time.
Or, like I say, you could just open up a little thing in your, you know, message
He's
box.
Not looking at that.
No, because then that makes noise and it goes
you
through the
board.
You
can turn the noise off.
Yeah, I can't figure it out.
You go to the preferences.
So you want me to disrupt the show? You want me to stop the show and say
Autumn,
something?
Where can we find you?
See what he does for me? He pushes me right back on the track. Autumn, where can we find you?
You can find me on all the social media at AutoPritz, P-R-I-T-T-S.
And Michael Albanese is doing shows and such.
Yeah, inmyownhead.com, at Big Man Mike. And come check me out at the Aurora Theater. Ticket sales are going through the roof. There's only a few tickets left.
Are we doing that? Are you doing two nights or one night?
There's two nights, two shows, two nights, Friday, Saturday.
Four shows. Which one should
we be? When was this? He just said it, but I wasn't paying attention.
Friday and Saturday.
Okay. Are you available either of those nights?
Yeah, sure.
What night should we go?
Saturday.
Saturday.
Okay, we'll go on Saturday.
Oh, wait.
What?
Friday.
No. Saturday.
Friday.
I'll go Saturday.
Well, maybe some of us will go on
you
Friday.
You pick, Eric, who you'd rather go with, me or Autumn.
Maybe I'll go both nights.
Okay. Oh,
I love
snap.
All of my children the same. Greg Russ, you do nothing anywhere. You're not on social media.
But people don't need to know the things I do.
Well, I mean, what is there a Twitter account? You need to start a Twitter account.
I have
You're
one.
Funny dude.
I have one. I tweeted about sandwiches for 2 weeks.
All right,
in
but
2009.
I mean, activate it again. I want to know what you're eating
right,
in 2009.
I do come back every once in a while and tweet about a sandwich, and I disappear again for 2 years.
Well,
so.
Then just tweet about sandwiches. And
all
right. That's fine.
All right, I'll do it.
I want to be able to tell people where they can find
you. Got
you
got it.
All right. That was The Morning Show. Kyle, thank you very much. You're awesome, man.
Yay, Kyle.
You're our first studio guest. That was The Morning Show with EVH. We'll see you tomorrow morning. Rocking horse people eat marshmallow pies. Everyone smiles as you drift past the flowers that grow so incredibly high. Newspaper taxis.
Train in a station with plasticine pauses with looking glass ties. Suddenly some